Hi, everyone. Arlene here. Welcome to Beacons of Balance. This is my wonderful co-host, Joanne.
Hi, everyone.
And we want to welcome all of you. If it's your first time joining us, thank you for being here with us. This is all about balance in our life, Beacons of Balance. We're the lights to bring the balance in. We live in, you know, chaotic world that's up, down, left, right. And we're here to share different topics and things and thoughts to bring us back into balance, to live a beautiful, peaceful, harmonious life, especially in this crazy world that we're in right now. Today, we have an exciting episode. Right, Joanne?
I can't wait for this one, Arlene. This is our
signs. We're open.
Now, all around us. We just have to be aware.
Yes. Red signs. So what do they stand for? They're actually, they're symbols. And they're subjective to everyone. You know, it depends on how we each, you know, personally interpret it. Like, in other words, somebody could see a snake or dream about a snake, and that could, for them, it could equal fear. They could be very fearful of that. For other people, it could represent transformation, right? So there's different things that we look at, and we see it in all different lights and different ways.
Right.
So,
you know, signs can also be humorous. And you know, we're all about the humor, right, Arlene?
That's for sure.
They could be messages of love. They could be reminders. Yes, and even warnings for your safety and well-being.
Yeah, exactly. You have to be aware. Always be aware. So who do you think are giving us these signs? I mean, the signs could come from, who knows? No, but a lot of times it's, you know, in our sleep, we see things, or we'll see things, of course, on the outside different. And they represent, you know, our loved ones that have crossed over, deceased loved ones. It could be our pets and our animals, because everybody loves our pets and that. And it's, you know, when people get this, and, you know, like when I had my store and everybody would come in, you don't have to explain it. You don't have to explain it, because everybody knows what it is. And I don't care if people don't think they're, you know, like the esoteric, because we're esoteric, it was spiritual. That has nothing to do with it. People know. You know, if a moth, you know, they're in an apartment cleaning out on Sophie's place because she passed away. And all of a sudden, in the dead of winter, a moth comes in and lands on their knee. They know. They would say, I know. And I'd say, you know, that's what it is for you.
Exactly.
Right?
And, you know, some of those examples are, it could be flickering lights. I have a friend that dimes appeared to her, and she knew it was her deceased husband. Pennies, messages on license plates. Dragonflies, butterflies, flowers, cardinals. A lot of people associate that with their deceased loved ones. Finding old photos that just mysteriously pop up out of nowhere, you know, in odd places, no less.
And also orbs.
Oh, yeah.
Orbs are big ones.
For sure.
You know, a lot of times I tell people, you know, check your photos. You'll see an orb. I mean, sometimes they could be an artifact or whatever. But sometimes there's something, I've had this, where people have just crossed over and an orb will appear in the room or whatever. And I'll say, magnify it. You know, when you bring it closer, you can actually see a face. And you don't get creeped out by, you know, I mean, we were in New Orleans and I took a picture of this woman. She was one of the street people, you know, entertaining.
Right.
A parasol and everything. I took her picture. When I say, I don't know where it is. The whole thing was covered in orbs.
Wow.
I was like blown away. I was like, holy crow. And I happened to see, I didn't see it then, but when I saw her, I ran into her like a couple days later. She was hovering, and I'm showing her, she wouldn't leave me alone. She walked all the way down the street with me. She wanted to know what it meant and everything. I'm like,
bang. Oh, that's funny. You know, when I noticed a lot of orbs, Arlene, is when we would teach courses in our house.
Yes.
Because the energy would be always bringing the angels in. And then especially when the children, my grandchildren, would play and they're jumping in total glee and happiness, orbs are shooting up from the floor for the ceiling. It's just, so yeah, I think
well, you know, it's interesting because when I cleared out my house, was from 1895. So before I put it, you know, and I know there's spirits in there, but I just, you know, they were fine. Spirits come in and out. The ones you have to, you know, release are the ones that kind of stay stuck between. They don't know where they are. But I did a clearing, and my friend who was the agent took pictures of the house. She goes, oh my God. And I had a wraparound porch around the house. She said, oh my God, Arlene, there's all these orbs outside. I said, well, I guess I must have chased them out and trying to come back in.
That was a cool house, Arlene. I remember that house. Yeah. You had that beautiful wraparound porch. It was like a beautiful lemon yellow.
Yeah.
It was just pure joy. And then you had the swimming pool and your lime green chair.
I still have the lime green chairs.
Oh, my God. That was so fun. So, what are some of the experiences or signs that come into your own personal life?
Yeah, we both have had quite a few. Okay, so some years back, I had to, I woke up one where I had like a golf ball that popped out by my kneecap, which is very unusual. And okay. Like, well, I guess I have to go to the doctors. And what do you think right away? You think the big C, you know? So I go in to talk to him. He goes, and of course the X-ray, I really don't know what it is. And he goes, it could be anything. But he goes, there's always a possibility. He goes, I should remove it arthroscopically. That was my first surgery. I'm like, And he goes, it could be the C. It can be that. So of course it's in your mind. Now you're thinking about it. So I go out and I'm like, first of all, I want to have surgery. And then I was thinking about that. So as I'm leaving and I'm going on the highway, I swear to God, I look over and here's a license plate and it says fat one. So I'm like, well, thanks a lot. No.
Oh my God.
Absolutely. And I started laughing. I giggled. I started laughing and I said, it brought me comfort. And immediately, instantaneously, I said, it's a lipoma. Which if you look up a lipoma, it's a fatty tumor.
A fatty tumor.
That's exactly what it was. It was not cancer. So there you go. So that was one of them.
They have a sense of humor.
Yeah. What 20 years? We'll go back.
There's several.
We'll go back and forth.
I don't know if you remember, Arlene, I don't know how many years ago. I want to say 5 or 6 years ago. Coca-Cola put out specialized cans for their product. And each can had someone's name printed on it.
Yeah, I know you said, I don't remember.
Maybe that was just a Midwest thing. I don't know.
People let us know in the comments. You could let us know if that's something.
Yeah, let us know if you've ever seen those.
I'm on the East Coast. I don't remember that. Although I don't buy Coke, so maybe that's a thing too.
It was only a short time.
Okay.
And my deceased mom's name is Rhodes.
Okay.
And I look up, I was thinking about her that day, and I look up and there's the Coca-Cola can with Rose on it. I'm thinking, okay, well, that's kind of a common name. But the can next to it said Irma, I-R-M-A. Now,
that's not a common name.
Irma was the name of the street that I grew up on as a child. That's my childhood street.
So I'm getting chills. Here's another sign, folks.
Oh, my God. Oh my God.
We call it the wave. We call it the wave from 30 years ago. But this is it. You could see it.
My hair's standing straight up right now.
My hair's up.
So she's probably right next to me, chuckling.
Well, she's over.
Then there was another time I was asked to be a keynote speaker in Yellowstone National Park at the Grand Lodge. This is a huge place. There were 600 people that came from all over the United States. And I was unveiling my new painting, the Unity painting.
Yeah.
I was adjusting the microphone, and I'm overlooking this huge crowd. And the back wall of this fantastic place was all glass, floor to ceiling glass.
Well, you were.
Adjusting the microphone, I'm looking out there. I always call in my spirit guides and everything to give me the right things to say. And there was a crane, a mechanical crane, parked right outside the window because they were fixing the roof at the time. And on the side of the crane, in gigantic letters, K-O-N-I-G. Well, I just about, when you start welling up and it's like, please don't let me cry now. Don't let me lose my, here on the stage in front of all these people. Because on my grandfather's passport, it's actually K-O-N-I-G. They later changed it to Koenig, K-O-E-N-I-G. I'm not kidding, Arlene. The tears were like, how am I going to speak? Okay, this thing is parked right in front of me.
Well, so And then, well, there's this. This was from many years ago. I had my shop, and I had a funeral director, female funeral. She used to come in. They're right across the street where funeral parlors talk about spirit. And,
right.
She was like, "Oh my gosh," she couldn't wait to tell me this story. She said, "Arlene," she goes, "I just did a funeral. They had the procession that goes to the cemetery, so they had the cars. And this is back now. This is how long ago it was. It was back when the cars had the antenna."
People,
anybody listens to this, they're not even gonna know what an antenna was. But anyways, it was a metal thing that you'd pull up on your front foot that would you get reception for the radio. Anyways, So the cars had this antenna. So the kids, it was their grandmother that passed away, and they were reminiscing stories, you know how you do. So they're in the car, and the funeral director's hearing this, and they were talking about, oh my God, remember Granny loved her plastic bags. She was a bag. She was like me, a bag lady. So she always saved those plastic bags that we don't have a lot of now. But anyway, she saved them. And they're talking about and sharing stories. All of a sudden, the funeral director said, you couldn't believe it. In the air, this bag whips around and it hooks on. Now it hooks onto the antenna. So it's like, you know, it's following them. It's going along with the car. Like,
yeah. Now that isn't a sign. I don't know what is,
but
right?
That isn't a sign. Yeah.
Honest to God. Here's one, and maybe you could, because I, to this day, Arlene, this has always puzzled me. You know, John and I used to always do these Caribbean sailing trips where we would, you know, charter a big sailboat. And we,
those were the days.
We would sail to the islands of our choice, away from the tourists.
Right.
To uninhabited islands. So we anchored off this one island, and we were turning in for the night. So I'm sleeping in the berth, and I was literally taken to another place, and it looked like a cathedral, but it didn't have any stained glass windows in it or anything. And there was a group of guides waiting for me at the altar. They all had plain linen outfits on, and I'm walking down the altar to them, thinking, "Oh my God, it wasn't. I knew it wasn't a dream. I literally was taken."
Helps it.
And they basically were telling me, thanking me for all the work I've done so far. And then they came down the two steps, and one put both of his hands on my shoulders and leaned in to my ear and said, "And you will be given $6,000. And I'm like, and they thanked me again for all the work of uplifting people constantly. And fast forward, I'm back on the boat. And John had gotten up in the middle of the night to go to the head. He called it the head on the
boat. Yeah.
I said, "Oh my God, you're not going to believe it." He's, "Oh, you're just dreaming. Go back to sleep." No, this wasn't a dream, John. I swear to God, I was literally taken somewhere. Well, fast forward, the following week when we got home, I did an art show and I made $6,000 to the penny. And you talk about God bumps.
Yeah.
What kind of sign was that? It's like,
you know,
so people don't believe there's another something higher force out there. Call it whatever you want.
And number six is a number of healing. It's a healing number. It means, yeah,
you're in break. Guess what? That's my life path number. I'm a 36.
Six. Yeah.
Six. It was,
well, I'm right at, I'm seven.
What? You're seven?
I'm a seven, yeah.
You know what? We should do a show on just life paths. That would be fun.
We'll do that. Leave comments, folks. Let us know.
Oh, my God. There's so many things we can talk about. Right, Arlene?
So there's another one. I used to volunteer at hospice, so I got close to two patients there, Anita and Grace. Anita, she was so funny. And so I would talk to them. And when you go to hospice, I was in the pastoral care area, and you listen. You don't talk, you know, for me.
Sure.
You listen. But then as you got to know them, they would, you know, they wanted to know what I did, and, you know. And they were sitting. Their beds were next to each other in this room. And they were funny. And you know they're not gonna be there that long, so I would connect with them, and then I started, you know, they asked questions, and you know, I told Anita, I said, you know, you may start seeing spirits coming, you know, your loved ones, you may see angels, you may see your parents, you know, whatever. Don't be, you know, I would try, don't be afraid,
because
they're a phenomenon that just happened. And they're there to help you and to bring you across and everything. So don't be afraid of it. So I would call them, because I couldn't be there all the time. I'd be there once a week. So I would call them at night to quiet them, do healing work every at 9 o'clock at night. So I called one day, and he goes, Arlene. She goes, "The nurse was over by my bed." And I said to her, "You see those flies? You see those flies?" And the nurse goes, "No, Anita, what flies?" And she said, I blinked to close my eyes, and you know, they were there. "So what do you think?" I said, I guess that's a sign for you. Maybe they came through as flies, you know, people get different things. But I thought that was funny. I thought that was humor, you know, so I chuckled about it. Well, she did pass away. Then Grace, who was next to her, You know, back then the insurance only gave you so many weeks to be in hospice. If you didn't cross over, they would bring you, had to leave, which was terrible. So they brought Grace back home, and I went to see her, and it was in the dead of, I say the dead of winter. It was like, right after, it was ice and snow here on the East Coast. And I drove, you know, she was out a distance, drove out to see her, and she's in a hospital bed on her downstairs. So I'm talking, you know, we're chatting, you know, we're talking. And then all of a sudden I hear, real, I mean, like you could hear it, was loud. Yeah. And I looked at her and I go, Grace, I said, do you hear that? And I'm looking around, I go, what the heck? All of a sudden this, I'm talking horsefly, it was huge. Horsefly, it is, comes around, it lands right on Grace's lip. So I shoot it away, because of course she couldn't move, because she had little gear. Yeah. She couldn't move. So I said, oh my, and then I start laughing. I said, oh my God. I said, that's Anita. I said, she wants to know what the heck we're talking about. That's okay, Anita. And then she was, it was gone.
Wow.
So there you go.
So, you know, talking about hospice, Arlene, and you know, you've been there. One of the very common signs of when people are ready to pass over, they reach up. Like, you know, their relatives are waiting for them, or their angels, their guardian angels. And we've talked to many that have been there, but, you know, didn't cross over. And they said, no, I actually saw the group of my relatives. I saw my archangel standing there waiting to welcome me. But apparently it wasn't my time, you know, because they just faded away. And then all of a sudden I got better. My brother-in-law who just passed, same thing. You know, my sister said he was reaching up. And it's pretty profound, because then you know, it kind of puts the family at ease to know that there's someone welcoming them, that they're not going to be alone in this abyss or this darkness. So the love is there, John.
Well, as we know just from past episodes with the near death, and you have people that do, you know, see the other side, they're there with the experience. They don't want to come back.
Who would want to come back?
They don't want to come back.
This is like the land of judgment, anger, hatred.
It's a life school.
It's only a school, right, Arlene?
It's a school where men are in it.
And it's tough. Lessons are tough. So if you could go to that place where it's pure love, just pure love, who would want to come back to this?
Yeah.
Or they look back at their bodies in bed to see what they look like in hospice. And it's scary. I mean, you're all, you know, you're not in your optimal health. You're all...
The thing that I've heard, it's hard when you come back, they say it's like squeezing 10 pounds of sausage into 1 pound skin. You're trying to shove all this energy because you're so, you're all energy, just pure energy.
Or slamming your body into concrete, you know, coming back really hard.
Yeah, yeah.
We've all been there. Where, did you ever like come back from a dream, Arlene? And you just like, it's like a shock to your body.
I used to have that a lot where where you feel it. Or have you had it where you're kind of like, you know, but you can't move.
Sleep paralysis.
Yes.
You're
not fully integrated.
Right. That happened to me when I was taking a nap on my back patio lounge, chaise lounge, beautiful day. And you could see, I was coming out of this sleep. And my eyes were blinking. I could see the birds flying and the way, and everything's moving. The trees were moving. But in that paralysis, I couldn't move my body. Next to me was this gigantic angel that was as tall as my house. So whatever that state is that theta? I don't know what
where
state.
You're in between. Yeah.
That's... You're in between worlds. A lot of amazing things happen.
Well, cause... I had... So here's another, talk about another sign. So one night, dreaming, whatever, and I saw, you know, like a lot of, I think I talked about this before, a lot of movement, it was fluttering, and it was like the sky.
Yeah.
I said, look here. I said, is it a bird? Is it playing? oh my God, birds. I said, but like you could hear the flapping, and it was like a loud, and all of a sudden I said, angels.
Oh my God.
I said angels. And I was in it. So I was in this movement. And as soon as that happened, poof, it was, I was back. I was, and I said,
I know. Doesn't it? Isn't that horrible when you come back to
and
this?
I couldn't get back there. But so the so this is okay. I still have my store then, and an artist came in. There was a local artist, and she did like murals in the cancer center at the Yale Hospital and everything. Really great artist. She comes in with this picture, and because she put pictures up of, you know, like used to that I could sell for her.
Right.
Oh my God, it was the scene.
Really?
Guy, and it was just like, you know, it was like the birds that look like just like, yeah. You know, she had a whole bunch. I went, so there was this.
Your confirmation.
For me. And guess what?
Confirmation.
I have it.
That's pretty cool. Another sign that I get a lot is when I'm writing, because, you know, I love writing my books. When I was writing my last book, I was working on Amelia Blue. I knew my parents and all my relatives were right next to me because I have a huge window in my office overlooking the backyard. And there was a flock of cardinals.
Hello.
It's like, these little cardinals. I'll tell you.
Hello. Yeah.
A lot of people see cardinals as a sign that your relatives are nearby. And it was only when I would write the book, Arlene, when I was in the middle of writing, they'd be there. And when I'd stop or go on to my next project, they'd be gone. It was only when
it's
I was
just,
writing.
Yeah, it's that confirmation. And everybody, you know, we know this. The only thing is, you know, sometimes people get obsessed with anything, or, you know, it may not be, you know, what it is. And I say, you know, sometimes the cigar is just a cigar.
Exactly.
You know, you can't read into it. But when those things are very strong and profound, and I know for a lot of people, we talk about this numbers, because people see multiple digits.
That's a big thing.
Multiple digits.
Big thing.
And this is all walks of life see it. Like, there again, person doesn't have to be spiritual, esoteric, or whatever. It's just, you know, you do it with people. People are curious, and, you know, so we know, like the 1111 is that we're being watched out for. There's new doorways. The universe is taking a snapshot of our wishes to come true in that, you know?
That's a big one. You know, sometimes I can be in a deep
sleep
and I feel a nudge on my shoulder and I look up and I look over at the clock and it'll just turn to 111. So what I do is I picture the most perfect thing that I want to manifest in my life. Because someone told me they're always taking a snapshot of your thought, what you want in life.
I told you when we were starting this, on my phone, it was 1111.
I see that a lot. I see that on license plates a lot. And then there's the other one I see a lot of is 222, which means don't give up 5 minutes before the miracle.
Uh-huh.
That's a pretty cool one.
And then 333, our masters and guides are all around you.
Right.
Which is that's a powerful one too.
Yeah. That's when I feel like that Christ energy or the Jesus energy is around me, when I have that 333. And we all have personal guides, as you know, our guardian angels. That could be them, you know, guiding you somewhere. And then the 444, boy, that was made really popular back in the 90s when I was still living in Connecticut. I forget the name of the book. Was by G.W. Harden. It was all about the 444 experience. That is, your angels are around
angels.
You.
Yeah, I love that. I love that one. And then the 5 is about new things coming, change. And
exactly.
The five. I get a lot of 555, that number.
Yeah. Arlene, that's why we need to do this show on numerology.
Yeah.
It could be so much fun. I love working on life path numbers, what you came in here to do. So it's all based on your birthday. And
there's people that are very involved in numerology. I mean, just like astrology, which, you know, and they're like, well, this is an old Dagwood. You remember Dagwood? His eyes would turn. He was on the comic strip. And
yeah.
No one's going to know. Some people may know. But anyways, yeah, this one particular man that I used to have that came to Angels to give a talk. So I always have people coming in to give talks. And he was like, wow. I mean, we went out for a bite to eat after, and I didn't want to ask personally, but he was like, okay, what's your son's birthday? And he was like, he didn't have to, he just did it like, I could see his eyes move him like,
wow.
And he knew automatically like that. I was like, whoa.
Yeah, I'm a 33-6 life path, which means we're the ones that were all about humanity, the caregivers. So that's a master number. You know, there's certain numbers, 11, 22, and 33, that you don't add those together.
Yeah, right.
So that's fun.
Yeah.
And then, Arlene, do you remember, this is going way back, probably when you had your angel shop. I forget the author, but it was called Animal Speak.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. I remember meeting him at
those. We had Animal Speak, Animal Speak cards also.
Yeah, but he was really big into the Native American science. And he was all about animals, obviously, Animal Speak. So he felt that if a certain animal came into your life, it
oh,
meant
that's
something.
Big.
Or if you dreamt about a certain animal. And it even went so far as if the animal came in from the left side, it meant something. If it was coming in from the right side, it was something coming into your life now. From the left, I think it was from your past.
Exiting? Oh, okay.
It was from your past life or past, just your past. And then if it's coming directly towards you, that meant
Run.
Another.
No,
no, like duck. Duck. There's your sign. There's your sign. I remember walking into a mall in
like
Milford,
these birds are
Connecticut.
Flopping on my head.
I know, just before I got into the main doors of this mall in Milford. Remember the mall in Milford?
Yeah, oh, yeah.
And this pigeon shit all over my head. I mean, I was like, it was like, it's like, what do you do? You know, I had to go home after driving all that way. No, the Italians, now they think if a pigeon shits on your head. So there you go. But not fun when it happens, I guarantee you.
Yeah. Well, so, the thing is to always, you know, this is about bringing everything into balance. And I think the key here also is just to pay attention, be aware.
Exactly.
But keep it real. You know?
Exactly.
And I think the universe talks to us. I mean, we think, when we say heaven, whatever, wherever we think we're going to, or our relatives, it's like way out there. And it's not. It's like, right, it's here.
It is.
You know,
it's just
we cross over. It's like you walk from one room into the next room. You just
exactly.
Press over.
My guides always tell me, it's like there is no other side. Your kind keeps referring to this other side when they're just in a higher vibration, a higher frequency than you are. So like they always use an analogy of the hummingbird's wings are vibrating so fast you can't see them.
But they're there. Yeah.
But your loved ones cross over. They're just in a higher frequency.
The other analogy I always used to give also is I'm a former x-ray technician.
Okay.
You can't see the x-rays. You can't see them, but when you see the film, there's the images out there, and it goes through your body.
Great.
So there you go.
Air, you can't see oxygen.
Exactly.
Without it, you can't exist.
Well, yeah, okay.
So, here. That's fun. So did you ever have a hawk, you know, fly around you? Those are usually messengers.
Right, there's a lot of hawks around here.
Coyotes, they say, are the tricksters. Like, who's the trickster in your life at the time? Maybe you're ready to sign a contract, you know?
Yeah.
I don't know about that, because I have coyotes all over the place in our yard. So I literally, right? They have a den really close by. So does that mean everybody in my life is a trickster? I doubt it. So don't
sometimes
grain of salt.
The energy just pulls things in also.
Yeah.
When we raise our vibrations, and you and I work on this all the time, and we've been with it for so many years and doing it. You know,
yeah.
When I had my shop, it was angel. It was like that was a beacon also. It was it was the light. And it would pull in everything. It was like it's just pulling. So what we think so called, you know, but I always say, you know, everyone came in, everyone,
all the drunks on Daniel Street.
All walk of life, but the ones that were in that place couldn't stay in. They
right.
Bounce out.
Exactly.
Not that they bounced them out, but they couldn't heal. They couldn't handle, absorb that. They weren't in
exactly.
That space. And a lot of people would walk in, they'd start crying.
Yeah.
I had so many
a boom zone.
Right.
You created a portal. You created
it. People still talk about it. Yeah. So
But, you know, don't take this stuff so seriously that you are in such fear that you can't get out of bed because, oh, my God, a beetle landed on the foot of your bed. Like, that means I can't leave the house. I mean, don't.
Well,
I've seen it.
That goes back to, but you know, then we should touch on this also, because it does go back to a lot of nationalities and a lot of how you're brought up in religion.
Good point.
In Greece, they have that eye, you know.
Yep.
The Italians have the horn.
I'm a loik.
To ward off
the evil eye.
Yeah, the evil eye. And
I still see a lot of people wearing that.
And the Greek, is the eye for protection. That's for protection also. I had one here, actually, because I went to Greece. I don't know where it is.
Yeah, I know what you're talking about. I see them on jewelry all the time.
I have it on a stone painted on.
But I guess what Arlene and I are trying to emphasize is don't let some of this stuff just paralyze you, you know, based on your cultural beliefs that are handed down through your DNA. I mean, because
remember, we have the
growth. Arlene, think of some of the, this is funny. Think of some of the crazy things that you were brought up as a child.
Salt over the shoulder.
Salt over the shoulder. Okay, do you know that when I wrote my book, I decided to do a research on that? Do you know that goes all the way back to the biblical times?
Probably, yeah.
Biblical times. Because when I was little and we'd knock over the salt, my mom said, quick, throw it over your left shoulder. And I'm like, and then you're programmed. You know, and I still, to this day, I do it.
But going back to biblical times, I mean, salt, that was used as an exchange, almost like a currency, right?
Well, this goes back to the days of Sodom and Gomorrah. And there was a couple fleeing because God was going to just crush this
soul.
And her husband said, now, whatever you do, don't look back. She looked back and she turned into a pillar of salt.
Yeah.
So they always felt that the devil was always on your left side chasing you. And that's why you throw salt. And you know, to this day, Arlene, you know, you've heard a million different ways to clear a house of bad energy. Oh, my God. What's the one where you put salt in every corner?
Oh, in each corner. Yeah, you have to go around a circle. That's, you know.
It's like, come on.
I mean, you could do what you want to do, but, you know, just like I know and you know, if you command something to leave you, there's supposed to be a universal law that it has to be honored no matter what we think it is. Aliens, the great, whatever. They have to honor that. And I know you have. I've had episodes with it. I've had the dark ghoulies come because, you know, you're with the people, whatever.
Yeah.
And I had things happen. And
But look, if somebody comes up to you and said, hey, for $350, I could clear your house. I'm like, hell. Because here's all you have to do. You're a child of God, perfect, whole, and complete, just the way you are. And just simply put it out there, like, creator, all that is, it is commanded that every corner of this house is purified, that anything not of the Christ energy, leave. Now, we demand you to leave. You don't need all these rituals and sage and salt and...
Well, we make people calling us have businesses that aren't going to be happy with this. Now, with that being said, you know, people go into church. Yeah, we are the church. We are right here. It's in us.
Right.
But it brings people a place of semblance and comfort, and that's fine. Burning candles, and you create an atmosphere here, and that's fine. But it's just not to get locked into it, to say, oh my Lord, if I don't do this, it's going to be a bad sign to bring me whatever. That's
Arlene, do you remember when you were little, and I'd hear this constantly, step on a crack.
Oh, break your mother's back. Yeah, I was going to bring that one.
Oh my God. And we were so careful not to step on those damn cracks. And then what about the black cat?
Well,
what
my
about...
kids must have stepped on my back because I'm going to crap for you.
What about don't go underneath a ladder? We'd always go around.
And the black cat?
And the black cat
crosses your path?
Oh, my God. That was guaranteed.
Under the ladder, that's really bad.
A black cat ran across the street. But a lot of this, as you know, Arlene, is handed down from generation to generation to generation. And if that salt thing goes all the way back to biblical times, holy moly.
Okay, so I'm going to throw it because we are laughter and humor. So I'm good. We're going to end with this because this is our time is okay up. So this woman was preparing supper for her husband, right? So she has the roasting pan that she gets out the roast. She cuts off the end of it and she throws it out. So, you know, she did it a couple times and her husband goes, why are you doing that? And she goes, well, I learned that from my mother. My mother did that. So he goes, that's weird. So she goes, I don't know. So she went to her mother. She goes, Ma, you know, how come you know, why do you do that? Why did it, you know, and I do it? She said, because I watched your grandmother do it. So then they went over to the grandmother's house and they said, why did you do that on the roast? And she said, what are you talking about? She goes, it wouldn't fit in the pan.
Oh my God. Yeah, that's a good one.
So there you go. That's what's hand to deck.
That is just so simple. But us humans make it complicated, right, Er?
That was a message I got loud and clear from the angels at my writing. Yep. They said, it's simple. Things are simple here, but we
if it's simple, we complicate them.
Because we have to make it a big, big picture.
Right.
So what we want to end with is just pay attention. Pay attention.
Exactly.
Play with it and see what happens. Let us know. Comment.
Right. Hey, tell us your experiences. What are some of the signs that you've post them below.
Yeah.
We'd love to hear. We love to.
Yeah, we love to.
You know, Arlene and I always interact with you in a text below.
And
family. We want to know. We care about you.
And please subscribe. It doesn't cost anything.
Where?
You put this really nice bar with a thing. Click out. We want to grow. We want to be here and stay. You know.
Right.
It's up to you guys. We're here for you. It's about you.
And it takes a lot to produce this show. You know, we've got a producer. You know, we're always interviewing people. We have to do research. So
we're not getting anything out of this other than
exactly. We do this out of love.
Sharing with you. And yeah, it's out of love. It's all about love.
Exactly.
About love, being balanced.
And share. Share these episodes. That's how we're going to grow. We want to get this because the world is upside down right now. And we're all about harmony and balance.
And eventually we're trying to figure it out where we could have a live talk.
Right.
Not live talk, but, you know, comments that we could.
Interactive.
Interactive. I don't even know what to call it, but yeah. But share it. Share it with others. And
exactly.
These are always archived, so you could come back to them and watch and spread it out there. And
right.
Yeah.
And let us know what some of your favorite episodes are. You know, that helps
what
us.
What you would like to hear in the future.
Or what you'd like to hear, exactly.
Or who you would like to hear.
Or a clean.
Yeah. So remember, always be the beautiful beacons of light that you are.
Yes.
Get out of, I'm pointing to my head, get out of this space and
right.
Drop into your heart. That's where it is. And shine it out there. We all need it desperately.
Right. And treat people with kindness.
Yes.
Kindness is key right now in this world.
We need it.
Right, Arlene?
Need it. Yes.
Beautiful.
Marvart's cheers always in love and light. Until the next time, we love you, love you.
We love you.
A host.
Thank you, R. I love you. Awesome show.
Bye.
Bye, everyone.